that was brought going to ask two persons from that side. Hallelujah. If you are redeemed and your burden of sin has been taken, just give a sharp, sweet testimony, a spiritual testimony in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Sing it again from that side.
Mm-hmm.
have our right to give our time.
That's right. Sanctified
Yeah. Jesus.
Hallelujah.
It has brought us into such fellowship. Oh God, with thee and your Father, with Lord and with one another.
Amen.
Oh, how wonderful, how marvelous.
Yes.
This our song.
Yes, Lord.
Shall ever be.
Yes.
Father, we just thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for the place of gathering.
I know, Lord.
You said that we ought not to forget the assembling of ourselves together.
Yes.
For there we know that your presence dwells.
Yes.
Amen. There we know the Holy Spirit,
hallelujah,
who is the comforter,
amen,
teacher,
amen.
Oh God, everything that we need.
Yes, Lord.
God, to exist, oh God, and to excel in thee. Then we look to you right now, Father God.
In the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
That self-same spirit will now rest upon your daughter.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That we
from the blood of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Last night we heard that we were once were pure. We were once as the children of God. When God called us, God did not create a sinful man. Amen. Amen. And it was through sin that we have separated ourselves from God. Amen. And God had to recall us back onto that place where we once was. Amen. And today my message is mainly just to remind us that we have already received that cleansing. And we need to remain in that position. Amen. We need to remain and remind ourselves that we constantly need the cleansing from the blood of Jesus. Without the cleansing, we cannot remain in the presence of the Lord. We need to be clean in order for us to stand in the presence of the Lord. In order for our prayers to be accepted. In order for us to pray and communicate with God, we need to be cleansed. We need to be holy. Amen. The Word of God tells us that when we study the Word, we can see that the nature of man alone is at war with God. Okay? Without God, without the blood of Jesus, us human beings, our carnal ways, is not acceptable.
No.
When we look at Colossians chapter 1, verse 20, amen.
Amen.
It tells us that having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself. Amen. So his blood makes peace with God. Man by nature, it is at war with God. Amen. So most of the scriptures that I'll be reading are from King James and also New International Version. Amen. So therefore we can see that it was through the blood of Jesus that that God has made peace with us. Amen. The way that men were, the way before the blood of Jesus Christ, the nature of men, we were at war.
Yeah.
Amen. There was no connection, there was no relationship, and God needed to get us back into that connection. God wanted to get us back into that relationship that we once was. When we look at Romans chapter 5, verse 10, the Word of God said, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son. Much more being reconciled, we shall be saved. Amen. Here we can see that we once was the enemy of God.
Amen.
Without the blood of Jesus, we are the enemy of God.
Amen.
We, our ways of being cannot be accepted in God's presence. And it's through the blood that brings mercy. It is through the blood that we receive grace. If Jesus Christ did not shed his blood, we would not have the mercy and the grace from God. By God looking at the blood that Jesus Christ shed, through that, God is overlooking our sins. He's overlooking our faults. Amen. The blood that Jesus Christ shed has given us the access to enter into God's presence.
Yes.
Without the blood of Jesus Christ, we cannot enter into the presence of God. Amen.
Amen.
And I would like us to look into also the sin that the Word of God tells us that it is sin that separates us from God.
Yes.
And what is sin and in which way we can sin. Amen. Here we can see from the definition of sin, we can find out that sin can be carried out through thoughts, attitude, action, or inactions contrary to the will of God. Amen. So therefore, we do not have to act in a sinful way. We can think in a sinful way. Our attitude can be in a sinful way, which will separate us from God, from the presence of God. Amen. So we don't have to physically have to sin in order for us to be separated in the presence of God. Our thoughts alone can separate us from the presence of God. Amen. And because it was so much for us to have to keep our carnal ways holy, that's why Jesus Christ's blood has to be shed. And when Jesus Christ's blood was shed for us, this sins that we cannot have, we cannot sometimes avoid in our carnal ways, God overlooks at us and grants us mercy through the blood of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So I'd like to remind us that not sin cannot only be carried out physically. Our attitudes, the way we think, the way we carry ourselves, it can be sinful. And the blood of Jesus was shed for that. Amen. Jesus Christ shed his blood for all sins, whether it be physical, whether it be our attitude, whether it be our mind. Amen. So it's not just a physical sin, because sometimes we tend to think when somebody commits murder, they are the ones that are sinful.
Yeah.
Amen? Compared to somebody that is just thinking negatively.
Yeah.
So I would like to remind us that Jesus Christ's blood was shed not just for physical sins, for all sins. And because of all of these sins hinder us from the presence of God. And when Jesus Christ shed his blood on the cross, he had made us whole from all sins. Not just part of the sins, all of the sins, whether it be a physical sin, whether it be a mental sin, whether it be a spiritual sin, all sins, the blood of Jesus cleanses us from it all. Amen. I would like us to go deeper into the examples that was given to us in the Bible of the sort of sins that Jesus was speaking to his disciples. When we look at Mark chapter 7, and this is one of the popular scriptures that we all know. Amen. And this is what Jesus told them. What comes out of a man, that defines a man.
Yes.
For from within, out of the heart of man, proceeds evil thoughts. Adultery, fornication, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lewdness, and evil eye, blaspheming, pride, foolishness, all these evil things come from within.
Yes.
And that's what defines a man.
Yes.
So Jesus was telling the disciples to understand that sin doesn't automatically come physically. It's within you. It's within your heart. In order for you to physically act sinful, it came from your heart, from your mind. And for, like I mentioned earlier, that most of the time we overlook the sins of our thoughts. We overlook that sometimes when we think negatively, that alone is a sin, and it separates us from God. Amen. So we are to be watchful of that. And another area that I would like us to, I will keep on going over is the cleansing and the protection.
Yes.
We need to understand that once we receive the cleansing of the blood of Jesus, we are protected.
Amen.
We are protected. The only time we will not be protected if we take ourselves away from that cleansing. We have to understand that God cannot do well with sin. No matter how great or how small it is, God cannot do well in sin. He can't even look at sin. He cannot look at a person that is sinful. And we need to really look at within ourselves and the way we carry ourselves. Because when we look at Jesus when he was on the cross, the last cry that Jesus cried was, my Father, why have thou forsaken me?
Yes.
Amen. And when we understand that, it wasn't that God forsaked Jesus. When we know the word that Jesus Christ carried our sin on the cross.
Amen.
And at that point, Jesus was carrying every sin there is to find on this earth. And there was no way God can do well in a temple that is full of sin. God had to separate himself with Jesus, because at that point, Jesus was carrying our sins. And he needed to separate himself. And throughout Jesus' journey, we understand that Jesus was saying that all that he was doing nothing of his own. It was the work of his Father. And he was expressing everything that he was doing and saying was coming from above. So we know, we can examine and know that everything that Jesus Christ was doing, he was getting direction from God. And at that point, it was the only time that Jesus Christ felt the separation with his Father. We need to know as the children of God when we are separated from God. That moment when the Spirit of God has left us, let us not fool ourselves that the Holy Spirit is always there. Let us not fool ourselves that we are always connected when we do something wrong. Let us not fool ourselves when we commit a sin, whether it be mentally, whether it be verbally, whether it be physical. Let us not fool ourselves that we are still connected with the Spirit of God. God had to take himself away from Jesus. There was no way that God can dwell in a temple that is full of sin. There was no way that God can look at Jesus, because at that point, he was not the Son of God. He was sacrificed as a lamb. At that point, he was no longer Jesus. He was a lamb that was being laid as a sacrifice. And at that point, he had all the sin there is for him to carry on this earth. And God cannot dwell. Jesus had to go through that by himself. So that's a reminder for us today that when we are carrying sin, when we are carrying in a sinful way, let us not think that we are still that holy temple that God is claiming that we are to be, that he needs to dwell in. Regardless of how big or how small we might think that sin is, sin is sin. Sin is going contrary to the law of God. Sin is doing anything, whether it be great or small, against the will of God. So if you find yourself doing anything, no matter how small, medium, big you may be, as long as it is against the will of God, it is a sin. Amen. I would like us to also look on James. James chapter 1 verse 23. The Bible, here in James, we will see that the Bible is telling us that the Word of God is a mirror. The Word of God is a mirror. And I would like us to remember this, that the Word of God is a mirror to us. When we hear the Word of God, when God speaks to us, it is for us to examine ourselves. Amen. It is for us to examine ourselves. God is getting us ready to go to heaven. We sing and we claim that this world is not our home. We're just walking through. Amen. So God is preparing us to go to heaven. So when the Word of God is coming out, we need to know that God is getting us ready into our everlasting home. We should not look at it as God is minimizing us. God has no benefit in minimizing us. God has no benefit in belittling us in any way, shape, or form. So we need to remember, any word that comes out, it is to equip us. It is to make us ready. It is to get us ready to that place where we want to be. Amen. One of the examples that I would like us to use is the children of Israel. When the word of God came out, the instruction that was given to them for the Passover. Amen. And I believe that is a story that many of us know of Moses and Aaron, when God spoke to Moses to instruct the children of Israel for the Passover. Amen. There was few areas that I wanted to bring out of our intention today to look into. Amen. And the story is mainly focused in Exodus chapter 12. And here we see God spoke to Moses and gave Moses an instruction of what the children of Israel should do. And this is what's most important, that when God gives instructions, he expects us to follow it step by step. We cannot pick and choose. You can be a child of God, but when the instruction is coming from God, and if you don't follow it, you will face the consequences. And here we can see, when we look at the word, we can see even the children, some of the children of Israel themselves, they became the victim for not following the instruction that God gave. God wanted them to remember the day that he set them free. God wanted them to remember that he delivered them from slavery. And God gave instruction to Moses that they need to start all over again. They need to start a new year, a new month. Their whole calendar timing needs to restart. And that he will pass over. Amen. And he gave them instruction on what to do. And here we see that not every one of them followed the instructions that God gave them. In Exodus chapter 12. For I will pass through the land of Egypt on the night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt. I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over. I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when strike of Egypt. Amen. This was the first warning that God gave to Moses to tell the children of Israel. Amen. And the land which they were, the other instructions that they were giving to was that they need to remember that the blood that they need to cover on their doorstep, this land needs to be blemished. Amen. That without blemish, and that there was an instruction on how they need to put it on their doorstep. I mean, they had to put it on top and on the side. And when you go into studying the Passover on the Jewish culture, we can see that this was a common costume. It wasn't something that was completely new to them. They were already familiar with this. But the extra information that was given was the sign. Amen. They had to put the blood on the top of the doors and on the side. So the side was the extra information that God gave to Moses. And not all of the Israelites and the Egyptians did this. And some of the Israelites, because it was a costume to them, they just put their blood on top of the top of the door front and not on the side. And some of the Egyptians, when they received this information, although they did not believe in the living God, they followed the instruction and their children were saved. They put the blood on top of the front door and on the side. And the word of God clearly told them that when they kill the lamb for sacrifice, on that very same night, the instruction was given to them on how they shouldn't boil it, in the way how they should cook it, basically. And also that on this very same night, they must eat all of it. And whatever remains, they should throw it away or burn it. Amen. So that very night, they had instruction on what to do. And the only information that I want us to focus on today, it was that a specific instruction was given to them. A specific instruction was given on how to protect themselves from the spirit of death. Amen.
Yes.
It was a clear information that was given to them. And all they had to do was to follow it.
The instruction
was given to them, and all they had to do was to follow the instruction. And sometimes we find ourselves short of this. When instruction is given to us, we find it hard to follow. And some of the instruction, we might look within ourselves that why should it be changed? Why should we do things differently than how we used to do it? Amen. We get that a lot, and it's a human nature. Some people find it hard to adapt in new things. Some people, when they are accustomed in a system, they like to keep themselves in that position. Yes. They don't like to adapt into new things. Mm. But when it comes to the work of God, we cannot put ourselves in the way we are. No. We need to follow the instruction of God. Mm-hmm. Here, the children of Israel, some of them became victims because they got themselves comfortable of how they do provide sacrifices. Yes. And on that very night, the spirit of death came. The angel of death came past. And the very people that claim they love the Lord, the very people that claim they know the true living God, some of them, they became victims of losing their firstborn simply because they did not follow the instructions. And some of the Egyptians that were just alongside with them, because they followed the right instruction, their firstborn was saved. And this goes to show us that you may be saved in church. You may come to church. You may claim that you are born again. But there will be a time, or there could be a time, where an instruction is given to you. If you don't follow it as it is, you will lose out and you will become a victim. Amen. Some of the children of Israel became a victim of this angel of death, although it was not set up for them. The message was not sent for them to be destroyed. The message was set up for them in order for them to receive the protection. That blood that was shed, that blood that was supposed to cover, that was supposed to put on their doorstep, it was for them to be protected. When they put that blood, it's for the angel of death to know that they cannot enter at this place. When we are covered by the blood of Jesus, the devil knows that he cannot enter your life. When we are cleansed by the blood of Jesus, the devil will know how far to go. We need to know and understand the power of Jesus Christ. The power of the blood that was shed on him. That blood not only protects us, it delivers us. Through that blood, we have received forgiveness. And many of us, we stop it from there, but we need to understand that it's not only forgiveness we have received from the blood. We also receive protection. We also have received deliverance. And he is a great example for us to know that through the blood of Jesus, we are protected. When you are cleansed by the blood of Jesus, you are protected. The angel of death can come, but he will pass over you. The devil of death can walk past your home. They will pass over. There are certain things, if you are protected by the blood of Jesus, it should pass over you. It cannot enter because you are covered by the blood of Jesus. Sometimes we overlook this authority that is given unto us. Sometimes we overlook the power that is within us. That power that God has given us through the blood of Jesus, there isn't any other authority we can have. There is no other protection that God can give us. The blood of Jesus is one of the highest protection that we have. And we need to use it wisely. Sometimes we do not use the blood of Jesus as we should. We do not protect ourselves from the blood of Jesus. We do not claim to be protected. Do you know that we can claim the blood of Jesus to cover our homes? We can claim the blood of Jesus to cover us physically. You can claim the blood of Jesus to cover your children. You can claim the blood of Jesus to cover the areas that you work in. You can claim the blood of Jesus to cover your house and the things within it. Physically, we can be covered by the blood of Jesus. Although we may not see the blood of Jesus, but we need to be able to reach to a point to claim the blood of Jesus over our life. We need to claim that we are protected by the blood of Jesus. It is through the blood of Jesus that we get that protection. It is through the blood of Jesus that we get connections from God. As we have mentioned earlier, that without the blood of Jesus, we haven't had that access point. Jesus Christ had to shed his blood. He had to die in order for that connection to come to be given unto us. Amen. And Jesus Christ's blood is the highest blood that carries power than any other blood. And when we look at the Old Testament, we can see a lot of blood was shed, a lot of animals was shed, a lot of time. Every time there was a sacrifice, an animal had to be killed. Amen. And even the high priest, before we have gained this access point to enter into the presence of God, the high priest will have to get themselves ready, prepare themselves, praying and fasting and asking for forgiveness in order for them to be ready to enter into this place of holies of holy. And before they do that, they'll have to provide a sacrifice. Amen. And it reached to a point where God knew that the sacrifice that they were providing, it was only a temporary protection. The children of Israel, when God gave them instruction to be protected by the blood, it was only a temporary protection. The blood of an animal can only protect you temporarily. And that's why they had to constantly do it. But today we are blessed. We are living in a dispensation of grace where we don't have to kill any more animals. We have an everlasting blood that always carries power, that always carries authority. So therefore we have to use it. If we do not use the blood of Jesus to protect us, we will become victim. Just like the children of Israel became victim of the angel of death, their homes were not protected. They did not use the blood properly. Their homes were not protected. Are we using the blood of Jesus properly today? Is our homes protected? If the angel of the angel of death were to pass over, would they have access to our homes? Can they enter and kill our firstborns? Are we protected by the blood of the Lamb? Is your life protected by the blood of Jesus? Are you covered by the blood of Jesus? Do you claim to be covered by the blood of Jesus every single day? Every single day of our lives, we need to claim to be covered. We need to ask God to cover us by the blood of Jesus. Because we can stumble anytime. We read earlier that God cannot look at sin. He cannot bear it. The moment we stumble, His eyes is off us. The moment we fall short, God's presence is no longer with us. And when God's presence is no longer with us, we are vulnerable to the devil. The devil can enter our homes and do all sorts of things that he wants because we are not protected. We need to remember that being protected by the blood of Jesus is for our own benefit. It is for our own good. It is for our own favor. Amen. Being covered by the blood of Jesus will not give the devil access in your life. Being covered by the blood of Jesus will not give the devil access to destroy you. Because you have a fence around you. You have something for him to fight on. In order for him to get access in your life, he has to enter. He has to fight the blood of Jesus, which he cannot do. So we need to know the authority that is in the blood of Jesus. I would like to encourage us to constantly, every day of our life, let us plead the blood of Jesus. Let us ask the Lord to cleanse us constantly. Even if we might not think we've done anything wrong, let's just ask for the cleansing. Just to be sure that you are holy in the presence of God. Because God will not look at us and say, well, that's a small sin. Just remain in my presence because this is something small. We will not get that from God. No matter how great it may be, no matter how small it may be, it can separate us from the presence of God. And the moment we are not in the presence of God, we will not gain the blessing. We will not be blessed if we are not in the presence of the Most High God. We need to be at the right place. We need to be in the presence of God. And the So the access point is already been given to us. What has been given to us to be in the presence of God is the blood of Jesus. And all we have to do is call upon the blood of Jesus. Because when we do something wrong, when we say something wrong, when we think of anything wrong, when we call on the blood of Jesus, God will look at us and remember what Jesus Christ has gone through in the cross and have mercy on us. We have to remember that in Romans chapter 5, it mentioned to us that we were enemies. And I believe it was Paul when he was speaking to Ephesians. Yes, it was Paul that when he was speaking to Ephesians, he was warning the churches, be careful. Because the very same people that are in the church, you're hearing the word, you're praying, you're fasting, you're doing all sorts of things. You can become the enemy of the cross. You can be the same people that are against the law of God. So we were once the enemy of God. But through the blood of Jesus, He has made us whole. Through the blood of Jesus, we can be called the children of God. And we need to remain in that position. We have been cleansed. The Word of God is encouraging us to be in that place. In order for you to receive the benefit, in order for you to receive the benefit, you need to remain in that cleansing place. Amen. Amen. And another instruction that was given to the children of Israel was to eat of the meat. Yes. Amen. Eat of those meat, all of it.
Hallelujah.
All of it. Amen. Yeah. And the idea of them eating all of that meat on that very night had a reason.
Yes.
And the word, when we study it, it tells us that when we come to God, because that sacrifice that they were killing, it was a temporary sacrifice. Amen. And we know that Jesus Christ is a living sacrifice for us. Amen. And He's a permanent sacrifice that was made to us. And we are to accept Him. So the meat, the sacrifice of the children of Israel that made on the night of Passover, God instructed them that they should eat all of that meat. And they should not worry about tomorrow. They should not worry about leaving it for later. They should not eat some for today and leave some for later. Amen. And that is an instruction that is given to us today. When we accept Jesus Christ as a living sacrifice, when we accept that Jesus Christ is the true Lamb of God and His blood was shed for us to have life, we must accept it, all of it. We cannot choose some of the things that Jesus Christ said and some of the things we don't do. We must follow Christ throughout. We must accept Him. The moment we have accepted Jesus, we must accept everything that comes with Him. We must accept His law. We must accept the condition. The principles of the children of Israel eating that meat, all of it on that night, it was for them to accept that sacrifice. Accept it for that moment, not to think of later. So when we come to Christ, when we accept the Lord, we need to accept God for everything. And we need to surrender our life for everything. We cannot say we accept God in this area and tomorrow we'll come back and think about whether we want to change on other things. Our life needs to be surrendered to God. The moment we open ourselves to Him, we must open up completely. When we're ready to serve God, we must serve God completely. We should not worry about what we're going to do tomorrow. We should not say we will do a little today and we will do some tomorrow. The whatever sacrifice that we present to God, whatever thing that we do to God, we must do it wholeheartedly. We must do everything. Amen. And we must accept Jesus Christ and accept the Lord for everything that He has done. Amen.
Bless the Lord.
And I'd like us to look into Revelations. Amen. Bless the Lord. Revelation in chapter 7. where we see that is one of the scriptures that we read today of our robe having to be white.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, who are these Arias in the robes, and where did they come from? And I said to him, sir, you know. So he said to me, these are the ones who came out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Amen. Revelation chapter 7, verse 13 to 14. Amen. And this is who we are. We have been washed by the blood of Jesus. We have been cleansed and made whole by the blood of Jesus in order for us to be able to stand in the throne of God. Without having to be washed by the blood of Jesus, we cannot stand in the presence of God. We cannot enter into the presence of God. We are not holy enough to stand in the presence of God, to stand in the throne. Amen. And it's through the blood of Jesus. It is through the blood of Jesus that has made us whole. And I would like to remind us again that every single day of our life, we need to ask the Lord to cleanse us.
Yes.
Every single day, we should ask the Lord to wash us in order for us to be holy, in order for our robe to be white. Amen. God is willing to wash us. He is willing and waiting to wash us. Jesus Christ's blood was shed for that purpose, in order for us to be washed, in order for us to be cleansed. Are we asking the Lord to wash us? Are we asking the Lord to wash our minds? Not just our physical, our minds. I mentioned earlier that sin cannot only be carried out by our actions, by our thoughts. The way of thinking. Do we ask the Lord to wash our thoughts? Do we ask the Lord to protect our thoughts by the blood of Jesus? Is your thoughts protected by the blood of Jesus? If the devil was to come to destroy your thoughts, have they got that access? Can the devil gain access in your thoughts to control you, to manipulate your mind, to start to think evil? And can the devil lead your mind to do evil? Is your mind protected? Is our mind protected by the blood of Jesus? Are we protected? We need to ask the Lord to wash us. Not just our mind, not just our body, our mind as well. Our minds needs to be washed by the blood of Jesus. Our minds needs to be washed by the blood of Jesus. Amen. Bless the Lord. And I would like us to look into Isaiah, the reward of being cleansed by the blood of Jesus. The reward of being cleansed. Yes. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18 to 19, I believe. Bless the Lord. But there is hope, because God, in his great love and mercy, has provided the blood of Christ as the means of salvation. God is willing to forgive. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Through your sins, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they may be red like crimson, they shall be white as wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat good of the land. Amen. This is the reward of being cleansed. God is willing to cleanse us. God is willing to forgive us. Through the blood of Jesus, God is willing to restore us. The word of God said, God is saying to us, come, let us reason. God is reaching in our level. God cannot reason with us if he is sitting on his throne. Amen. God cannot reason with us if he's sitting at his throne. We have to understand the benefit of God. We have to understand how great God is to us. He wants to reason with you.
Yes.
He wants to make things right. He wants to restore things with you. He wants to restore that relationship. He wants to make things better. Amen. God is telling us, come, let us reason together. Regardless of how bad your sins was, regardless of how devastating you were, the word of God is telling us to come.
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 You can be washed.
Yes.
We can be washed by the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
Regardless of how bad we may think our sin has been, the word of God is telling us to come. Come. We can be washed by the blood of Jesus. God can wash us and restore us. Amen. But there's condition. Just like how there was condition with the children of Israel on how to put the blood on their doorstep, there is condition for us today. We need to be willing and obedient.
Amen.
If we are willing with God, if we are willing and obeying God's word, God can wash us. We need to be willing. The desire is to come within yourself. Nobody can put a desire for you to serve the Lord. Nobody can force you to come. It needs to come within you. Amen. Jesus, when he was speaking to the disciples about the sin and what will separate us from God, he said, within a man. Within a man, out of a man's heart. It will come from your heart.
Yes.
Amen. All these bad and sinful things we think we can do, it comes from within. So is willingness. Willingness will have to come from within.
Yes.
Nobody will put it in you. You can receive all the teaching and the preaching there is, but if you do not have the willingness, God will not force Jesus Christ's blood to be covered on you. You need to want that blood to be in your life.
Yes.
You need to claim that blood in your life.
Yes.
You need to claim it out. You need to confess it out of your mouth.
Yes.
It needs to be coming out of your heart that you want your homes to be protected.
Yes.
You want your life to be protected.
Yes.
You need to claim that you want that protection.
Yes.
You need to claim that you want that cleansing of Jesus. You need to claim the protection that comes from the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
If you don't claim that protection, you will not receive the protection. If you don't follow instruction properly, you will not receive the protection. Some of the children of Israel, they did not follow the instruction. They just put the blood anyhow. They just put it anyhow. They just thought, well, the blood is at the door. And they're inside the house. And I'm sure some of them were feeding themselves as well. Feeding themselves, thinking that they are protected. But when the angel of death came past, the firstborn, there were lots of people mourning that night. A lot of people was mourning. A lot of families that they thought they were protected. A lot of homes that they thought their children were saved. Because they had their blood covered. But because they did not follow the instruction properly, they became a victim. We can also become a victim if we do not follow the instruction of God properly. If we don't follow step by step what God is telling us to do, we will become victims. If we are making the word of God to be comfortable in us, we will become victims. Because sometimes when the word of God is being preached, we try to make it comfortable. We pick what it suits us.
That's right.
When it comes to serving God, we will serve God based on how we feel. When we're presenting something to God, we will present it on how we feel.
My God.
And these are the sort of warnings that Paul was giving to the Ephesians. Paul was warning the Ephesians that you can easily get yourself caught up in religion. You can easily get yourself caught up because the children of Israel, they became victims because of religion. Because it was something that they were accustomed to. They were accustomed to killing the lamb. right. And sometimes because we are accustomed into doing it, we do it so many times that we don't even think no more. We come to church on Sundays, we don't even have to think that we have to come to church no more. The purpose of coming to church is no longer on our mind. That's when we miss the mark. We will miss the mark when things become a costume. Because an instruction will be given, because you're so used to doing things the way that you feel you know how to do it. The way that you've been doing it for so many years. You've been safe for 10 years. Why should anybody come and tell you to do anything different now? You are born again. Why should somebody come and tell you what to do? The costume of doing things, it will lead you to be a victim. You will become an enemy of the cross. And this is the warning that Paul was giving to the children of Ephesians, that they need to be careful not to fall into that trap of becoming an enemy of the cross, of doing things for God, and you begin to do it so much that you're no longer valuing God. You're no longer valuing the service. You're no longer valuing the sacrifice that you are presenting. You're giving your offering so many times that you're not even valuing your own offering that you're giving to God. You're providing a service to God. You're no longer valuing yourself. That is what the enemy wants. The enemy wants us to be blinded in when we're doing the things of God, in order for us not to have that access point. So we need to ask the Lord to wash us. Wash our minds. Wash our eyes. When we see things, amen, to be able to distinguish this is from the Lord. To be able to distinguish this is not from the Lord. If your eyes are not washed, if you do not have a spiritual eye, you will not be able to tell whether what I'm saying tonight is true or not. We need to pray that God washes our mind. That God washes our understanding. That we are able to see clearly. And when we're serving Him, that we're doing the right thing and we are still focused. We are to examine what we are receiving. How can we examine what we're receiving if we cannot even get ourselves into the right position? How can we tell if something is wrong when we are in wrong? How can we see something that is not cleansed? How can we see something that is cleansed if we are not cleansed? You need to be clean to see dirt. If you are dirty yourself, how can you see if somebody else is dirty? You will think it's normal. We need to pray that God cleanses us. That God washes our hearts, our mind, our spirit, our eyes, our mouth. That the things that we say is holy. The things that we think of is holy. The things that we see is holy. The word of God clearly tells us that our eyes, our ears, and our mouth are access to our soul. Now, if our ears are hearing the wrong things, our mouths are saying the wrong things, our eyes are seeing the wrong things, how can our soul be cleansed? How can your soul be clean if what is going in is not clean? If you cannot tell the difference between what is clean, how can you claim that your soul is clean? We need to pray that our access points, what gets inside of our soul, the things that we hear, we need to make sure that is washed by the blood of Jesus. Amen. The things that we see, we need to make sure that is washed by the blood of Jesus. The things that come out of our mouth, we need to make sure that is washed by the blood of Jesus. We need to make sure that whatever is entering our soul is cleansed. Because if it is not cleansed, we will not be cleansed. If what we hear is not washed by the blood of Jesus, we would not be washed by the blood of Jesus. We would not be holy. Let us remember that the blood of Jesus was given to us in order for us to be holy, for God is holy. If we are not holy, we cannot be in His presence. We cannot claim that one day that the angels will look at us and wonder, who are they with the white robes? We can if we are holy,
yes,
if we are cleansed the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
We need to ask God to cleanse us. Our physical body needs to be cleansed every single day. Our mind needs to be cleansed. The things that we say, we need to pray to God to cleanse our mouth. The things that we say, the things that we see, the things that we hear, it needs to be cleansed in order for us to be protected. We cannot claim God to protect us. Pray God to protect us. Protect us by the blood of Jesus. Protect my home with the blood of Jesus if our home is not cleansed. If our home is not cleansed, it cannot be protected by the blood of Jesus. We need to be washed first in order to be protected. Being protected from God comes after being cleansed. God cannot protect sin. Sometimes when we ask God to protect us, if something is wrong, is that we're asking God to protect a sin. We're asking God to favor a sin. We're asking God to heal a sin. We're asking God to deliver a sin. In order for you to receive that protection, you must be cleansed. You must be washed. After receiving the washing of the blood of the Lamb, you will gain access to be protected. After your home has followed the instruction that is given to God, you will be protected. Amen. God cannot protect a home that is not washed. If your household is not washed, it cannot be protected. If your thoughts are not washed, you cannot be protected. Because the reason why you will not be protected, you've given the devil an access point. God cannot protect you when you have an open door to the devil. And when we look at the word of God, all he needs is one step. The devil needs a little step to get into your life. But for him to come out, if he gains that access in your life, he will make himself so comfortable that you will have to fast. You didn't have to fast for him to come and trouble your life. You just had to make one mistake. But in order for you to be delivered, you will need praying and fasting in order for you to be set free. So we need to be watchful. It's easy to make a mistake. It's easy to fall short, but we need to remember the moment God has stepped out of our life, when the moment we're no longer in the presence of God, as a child of God, you must know. Just like how Jesus realized straight away when he was on the cross that God was no longer with him. He cried out, "My Father, why have you forsaken me?" He realized that God was no longer there. He was standing alone. Can we tell when we are standing alone? As a child of God, can you tell when you make a mistake and God has stepped out and you're no longer in the presence of God? Can we tell that we have stepped out? And it's very dangerous if you are a child of God and you cannot distinguish if you're no longer in the presence of God. You're in a very dangerous place if you are a child of the living God and you're not in the presence of God and you can't tell it. It's very dangerous. And the moment the devil can get you to be in that position, he will want you to remain there. Because you will still come to church. You will still do all sorts of things that you do, but you're not in the presence of God. And a lot of people, that is the strategy that the enemy does. He plays with you. And sometimes we tend to think that in order for you to be possessed with the devil, you just need to be far from God. You can be in church. You can be in church. And if the devil can gain access in your life, that's all he needs. He will destroy your life in the church. He will destroy your life in prayer meeting.
Yes.
Because your eyes is not washed. You cannot distinguish. You cannot tell the difference from sin, from doing the wrong thing.
Yes.
So we have to remember, that when we are washed by the blood of Jesus, God has made us holy. We need to act holy. We need to behave holy. We need to talk holy. Amen. We need to walk holy. We need to remember that God Himself is holy. In order for us to receive the benefit, the Word of God is telling us that we need to be willing. We need to be obedient and be willing. Without a willingness, without being obedient, we cannot receive the blessing from the Lord. Amen. I would like to encourage us today that let us ask the Lord to cleanse us. Every single day of our life, let us ask the Lord to cleanse us. Let us make it a routine that every day we wake up, we ask for the Lord's cleansing. Before we go to sleep, let us ask the Lord to cleanse us. Let us ask the Lord to wash us. Wash our minds. Wash our hearts. To make us holy. Whatever will hinder us with God, let us ask the Lord to wash it and take it away. Because the Word of God said that there is nothing, regardless of how our sin may be, God is willing to make it white as snow. He's willing to reason with us. Regardless on how far God we may think we are, we need to ask the Lord to wash us. And once we receive the washing, we will gain the protection. We will be able to ask the Lord to protect our health, that no heart sickness will come our way. We will be able to ask the Lord to protect our homes, that no death will come our way. We'll be able to declare life over our children, that death will not come over them. We'll be able to ask God to protect our jobs, protect our everyday life, protect the people that are around us. That can only be done if we are cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Let us ask the Lord tonight to cleanse us, to renew us, that anything that is hindering us to be in His presence, that is washed away. That when we provide a sacrifice, our life should be a living sacrifice, that it will be accepted unto Him. We need to be washed by the blood of Jesus. Every single day of our lives, we need to be protected by the blood of Jesus. There is no higher authority that can overtake our lives if we are protected by the blood of Jesus. There is no higher spirit that can destroy our lives, our hope, if we are protected by the blood of Jesus. Let us ask the Lord to protect us. Let us ask the Lord that we don't fall short of anything that will make us unclean, that will separate us from His presence. Let us ask the Lord that we will always remain clean and holy and always remain in His presence in order for us to receive the blessing. Amen. Let us remember that God cannot bless the unclean. God will not deliver you if you are unclean. God will not set you free if you are unclean. We need to be cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Our body needs to be cleansed. Our spirit needs to be cleansed. Our thinking needs to be cleansed. Our ears, what we hear needs to be cleansed. What we say, what we see needs to be cleansed. May God bless you tonight. In Jesus' name.
Bless the Lord.
God has got to send a message tonight.
Amen.
For us, we can't fight.
If that home you behave anyhow,
my Lord,
and the street anyhow, yes. But when you come to church, you act as if you're black.
My Lord.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Jesus.
And it goes to all of us.
Yes.
Sometimes you look at somebody bad. Uh-uh. Sometimes you say a bad word about somebody.
Yes.
Sometimes your thought is not right.
My Lord.
Somebody. Yes. But praise be to God. We have God's standard.
Yes.
Pastor Hans, join me here. We're going to sing this song here tonight with all.